Without further ado, Nicholas.
Okay. Hello everyone. So for my this project was actually done. I just graduated from SUTD. So this project was done last year for a module called engineering design. So this is the ruggedized rolling robot that we came up over the course of the term. So the design challenge given to us was that we had to fabricate and design a rolling robot. It just needed to be spherical, and it needs to be ruggedized. And in terms of ruggedized, there's a lot of freedom for you to choose. What do you mean by ruggedized? So you can choose whether you want it to move over rough terrain or whether it can withstand impact. And that's what my group did. So we focus on the impact portion where it's able to be dropped from a certain height and protect all the interior electronics and as well as the shell. So the features that we eventually came up with was that the outer casing could be easily removed. It's a strong modular, and the powertrain is actually a dual-axis pendulum, similar to what you find in the BB-8. And it's supposed to provide something like an ad hoc wireless network in the field. And there's also built-in PID stabilizer so that when it moves or when it traverses, right, because of the weight of the dual-axis pendulum, so it causes a lot of wobbling. So that's why we also put that in place. So maybe I'll just show y'all. I don't have an actual product because it's with the school. So I'll just show you the video. Oh shit. Yeah, there's no sound. So these are just some of the interiors. Oh, sorry, it's a bit fast. Then I'll just skip to the drop test. Yeah, so we dropped it from 4 meters, and to give you some context is that we use a hamster ball on the interior. So the hamster ball, if you drop from a height or table height, right, it cracks instantly. But as you can see, based on the shell, this shell costs us only $15 to make, but a lot of time to do. So yeah, you can see from the video. So I just attached it with cable ties, and it's a quite tight fit. Yeah, so you can see that there's no damage on it. You can see some. I'll just forward.
Is that a real hamster in there?
No. Yeah. So this is the movement of the ball with the dual-axis pendulum. So it's rather smooth without the. Yeah, it allows it to move in any direction if you combine the movement of both pendulums. But with the shell, right, it becomes very difficult. And that's why we had the PID controls to allow your controls to be exactly where you want the ball to go to. Yep, that's about it. Yeah, so the focus of the shell, maybe can pass around. I have the outer shell itself that we just cut from dual walk cardboard. So this was cut and designed through, we did SolidWorks, then after that we laser cut. So using a laser cutting machine is not a very good idea for cutting cardboard because, just with a bit of flames, you can still get it out. So the inspiration of this entire protective shell is biomimetic in the sense that we actually didn't want to over-engineer something. We looked to nature, and that's when we look at the woodpecker. So the woodpecker is able to withstand, you can see that it's able to tunnel through tree trunks with ease, and it's completely protected. And why is that so? It's because it has 4 layers of protection in its skull. And we mimic this in our design, and you can see this. The outer case is a solid layer, then the skull is the metallic layer, and everything has a certain purpose. So essentially, we were making our own composite. Yeah. So this is the design summary of the entire product, and you can see that the current piece only has cardboard, So the cardboard itself provides a rigid mesh for it. And the second layer, we have the high density foam and to absorb shock, followed by the hamster ball that provides yet another rigid layer. And finally, on the outermost shell, right, we filled it with silicon to absorb the shock as well. So these four layers of protection allow us to drop it from 4 meters, which is much better compared to when it initially rolled off the table a lot of times. And we have to purchase like maybe 10 hamster balls to do our test. And you can see that the internal, the robot itself makes use of the dual axis pendulum system to shift its center of gravity for movement. Yep, so you can have a better close-up picture of it. So we water jet all these aluminum pieces. So the thing that we needed to tweak was the weight management of it, because the different axis of movement, right, caused it to wobble a lot. So how we designed it was we have a lot of individual pieces that you can see that we stack on top of one another. Then we adjusted the weight accordingly. And the robot is, we use a DF robot, Romeo 2. It's Arduino based. So it's a very good bot to use for robots, because it has a lot of connectors for you to control motors and servos easily. And we use a high-top Polulu micro motor. So the motors are this small that actually spin the pendulums. And the entire thing is designed through with the use of SolidWorks and some CorelDRAW software for laser cutting. Yep. So to control the robot, we focus most of our efforts on the hardware of it. So we didn't really have time to actually write out the entire application on our own. So we made use of AdInventor, and in the end, the thing spent like a few pages. So yeah, but it works. So we came up with a very basic application. So it actually controls the robot by Bluetooth, and it's quite blur, but I'll go into the app itself. So when we created the app to control the robot, it uses the XB Bluetooth. So you use a handphone and you just move the controls. So this is something like your joystick. So initially, we just calibrated the motors to allow it to move forward and in different directions. But the issue is that it was behaving very erratically, because we couldn't, when we move it forward, then because of the weight difference, like, a slight shift caused it to go off course. When we added the shell, it made things worse because the ball couldn't even move. So it was a big problem. So that's where we decided to actually add in extra controls, tweak the motors as well. So what we did was, you can see that this we can calibrate the motor readings, and you can add accordingly to increase the strength of the motors. And followed by, so how it works is that when you're moving in one direction, the PID actually stabilizes the robot in the other direction. So it measures the gyroscopic readings, and this allows it to move straight. So initially, our robot will move in a random curve. Then during our first few interactions with our instructors, we are saying, oh, we wanted it to curve, but no. Yeah. So eventually, we implemented the PID damper. So PID stands for proportional, integral, and derivative control. So P is for what you experience in the present state. I is over a period of time, and D is what it predicts in the future. So we calibrated. The app allows us to calibrate all these individual values, and eventually, because of this, we were able to move it much better compared to the initial state. Yeah. So you can see we changed the KP, KI, KD individually, and there's a lot of calibration involved with the robot, simply because there's so many ways that it could move. One big problem it was experiencing is that it was constantly slipping. So you could see the pendulums going round and round and round, but there's totally no movement, simply because the shell itself was hindering it. That's not me. Yes. Yeah. So over there, so within the app itself, we also have some communications to, so we could send messages to the robot, and that's where we connected to the Bluetooth from top. Yep. So that's about it. Thank you. And no question.
Hey. Is it better?